and welcome everyone, and welcome to the next session of the MCQs. And the exams are fast approaching, guys. You really need to buck up your preparations. And in the process of bucking up your preparations, of course, the one and only thing which you need to do is to brush up the MCQs as much as you can. Revise them as many times as you can. Just go through them as many times as you can so that you are able to understand the concept and are able to learn the probable options and probable answers well. Okay, so in this session of Law and Ethics MCQs, I am specially going to focus on the bit questions which are released by the Institute of Cost Accountants of India, and these questions hold a special emphasis, hold a special place, because just a few months before the examination, this particular MCQs were released by the Institute. So yes, they hold paramount importance, they hold really great value in your examination. So ideally, yes, you should do these MCQs in a very, very concrete and a very, very focused manner. And the copy of the MCQs is available in the link which is given in the description box. You can just download the MCQs from there and revise thereon. Yes, the format which is being given to you is a absolutely open printable format, PDF format, so you can print, get those MCQs printed by your own. And yes, we'll succeed in our CMA foundation examination, and yes, we will see ourselves in CMA Inter very, very, very soon. Okay guys, so let's start the bit questions. Today's session of MCQ, which have been issued by the Institute. A void contract. So I think the question wants you to define void contract. A void contract is void from the beginning, is valid in the beginning but becomes void later on, is enforceable at the option of one of the contracting party only. None of the above. So guys, a void contract is not void from the beginning, is not void since its inception, because if it's a void since its inception, then it is not a contract at all. So void contract is definitely valid in the beginning. In the beginning it is a valid contract, but afterwards it becomes void. So this is the correct answer. Can you tell me what is point number C? What kind of contract is point number C? Is enforceable at the option of one of the contracting parties only. This is voidable contract. A contract which is void at the option of one of the parties is a voidable contract. Okay, sir. Question number two. Which one of the following does not connote goods as defined in Sales of Goods Act? So you need to tell which one of the following is not a good. Sir, A, money. B, animals. C, debt. D, both A and C. So which one of the following is not goods? Guys, the answer is money is not good. Of course, there's a specific exclusion to it in the Sales of Goods Act, and debt is also not a good. So the correct answer is D, both A and C. Goods are not money, goods are not debt. So both A and C are not goods as connoted by the Sales of Goods Act. So the correct answer is D, both A and C. Okay, sir. Acceptance take place as against the proposer. So a person who is the proposer, who is the offerer, who is giving you the offer, the acceptance takes place as against the proposer. When does the acceptance take place? This is what you need to tell. When the letter of acceptance is posted by the acceptor. B, when the letter of acceptance is received by the proposer. C, when the offeree writes the letter of acceptance but does not post it. And D, all of the above. So guys, if you look at the perspective of the proposer, then the acceptance is complete from the angle of the proposer when the acceptor posts it in the post office. At that point in time, we believe that acceptance is complete. So acceptance is complete as against the proposer when the acceptor posts its acceptance in the post office. Then we say that acceptance is complete. So the correct answer is A, when the letter of acceptance is posted by the acceptor. Soon as the letter of acceptance is posted by the acceptor, the acceptance is called as completed. Okay, sir, got it. Question number four. conditions are stipulations essential to the main purpose of the contract, collateral to the main purpose of the contract, either A or B, neither A or B. Answer is A. Conditions are the stipulations or the parameters which are essential to a particular contract. So for example, a bed should be soft and you should be able to sleep on a bed. Mattress should be made of some soft material which is on which you are able to sleep well. So that is a prime condition to any sale of mattress. So yes, condition is essential to main purpose of the contract. Guys, what is collateral to the main purpose of the contract? Warranty is collateral to the main purpose of contract. So B is warranty, A is condition. Fifth, which of the following is an offer? You need to tell which of the following options is an offer. A mere quotation of terms by trader. So quotation is forwarded by the trader. Is that an offer? A quotation of the lowest price in answer to inquiry. Is that an offer? Advertisement for sale or auction of goods. Is that an offer? Or bids in an auction sale. So the correct answer is bids in an auction sale is an offer, which the auctioneer has to accept or reject. An offer is made by the bidder. An auctioneer has to accept or reject the offer. So the correct answer is bids is in an auction sale. No, quotation is not an offer. Quotation of lowest price in offer to an inquiry is definitely not an offer, because the inquirer can still refuse that lowest quotation. He can do that. So it's not an offer. Advertisement for sale of auction of goods, not an offer. But bids is in an auction sale is definitely an offer. Question number 6. The general rule of Sales of Goods Act is prima facie passes with. So the general rule of Sales of Goods Act is risk. Prima facie. Prima facie means at the face of it, at the fact of it. Prima facie, the risk passes with A, ownership, B, possession, C, delivery, D, custody. Guys, the general principle is that risk passes on with ownership. Soon as ownership is transferred, the risk is also said to be transferred to the buyer of the good. So the correct answer is ownership. Which of the following has the correct sequence? Offer, acceptance, contract, consideration. Offer, acceptance, consideration, contract. Contract, acceptance, consideration, offer. This is absolutely wrong, because offer cannot be the last one for sure. Offer, consideration, acceptance, contract. Of course, this is also not the right sequence, because offer plus acceptance make a promise. And then consideration is added to it to make it a agreement. Then legal enforceability is added to it to make it a contract. So the correct answer is B. Offer, acceptance, consideration, and contract. The correct answer is B. This is the right sequence. So guys, the sequence should be pretty clear to you. Offer, acceptance, both of these culminated together becomes a promise. Promise plus consideration makes a agreement. Agreement plus legal enforceability makes a contract. So this is how the sequence is. Okay, sir. Eighth, the exceptions to the rule a stranger to a contract cannot sue are. So the general rule is a stranger to contract cannot sue. Privity of contract is the name of this particular rule. Yes, sir. So what is the exception to this general rule that stranger to a contract cannot sue? The exception is beneficiary in case of a trust, family settlement, assignment of contract, all of the above. Guys, the correct answer is all of the above. In all of the above situations, a third party to a contract can sue. In case of beneficiary, in case of a trust, he can also sue. Family settlement, a third party can sue. Assignment of contract. So who is the third party in case of a family settlement, guys? It's the women of the family who have not been consented or who have not been taken into account while taking the decision. But the decision was in favor of them, because HUF, women have got a right. So if all the men of the family have decided that a portion should be given to the women of the family, then women of the family, despite of not being a party to that particular settlement, can sue before the court. Then assignment of contract, if a contract is assigned to a third party, then the third party is very well in a position to sue for the contract. So the answer is D, all of the above. Okay, sir. Delivery of the keys of a godown. So you deliver the keys of the godown where goods are kept amounts to actual delivery, because the delivery is done for the goods. So does it amount to actual delivery, symbolic delivery, constructive delivery, or all of the above? Guys, the answer is symbolic delivery. When you transfer the keys where godowns are kept to a third party and tell them that okay, the goods are kept, please take them, then it is symbolic delivery. So what is actual delivery? When you actually put up the goods in front of you and give it to the buyer, then that is actual delivery. Sir, what is constructive delivery? Constructive delivery means you have delivered that particular good in a constructive manner, which means that if you hand over the keys of a car to a particular person, then you have constructively given the car to that particular person. If you have given the keys of a particular house to another person, then you have constructively transferred that house to that particular person. That is constructive delivery. But this is symbolic delivery. Okay, sir. So the correct answer is symbolic delivery. In Indian law, consideration must have been done at the desire of the promiser. Very true, guys. In Indian law, the consideration should flow from the promiser. If it is to be done at the instance of a third party or without the desire of promiser, it is consideration, not a consideration, offer, promise. The correct answer is not a consideration. If the consideration flows at the instance of a third party, so there's a difference. One is it is flowing at the instance of a third party. Second is it is flowing from a third party. So consideration can flow from a third party, but consideration cannot flow at the instance or desire of a third party. There's a difference between it. And in the lectures, we have in depth, in detail discussed this particular aspect. So it is not a consideration at all. Okay, sir, we remember it. Is a pro note executed in favor of a minor good in law? So first of all, what is this pro note? Guys, pro note means promissory note. It's a short form for a promissory note. Okay, sir. Fashionable term, sir. Yes, fashionable term. So is a promissory note executed in favor of a minor good in law? So law would be in your favor if you say that, okay, in favor of a minor, I'm issuing a promissory note. Answer is absolutely yes. Unless or until some liability is created on a particular minor, every contract with a minor is good enough, good in law. Minor can sue you for the beneficial provisions which are there in a particular contract. So yes, a promissory note which is drawn on favor of the minor, it is very well under periphery of law, and minor can sue on that promissory note. Yes, please. Answer is yes. Question number 12. Right of stoppage in transit. So when your goods are going to a buyer's place, do you have right to stop those goods in transit? Can be exercised by an unpaid seller where the buyer is solvent, where the buyer becomes insolvent. C, acts fraudulently. D, acts smartly. So guys, the law prescribes that where the buyer has become insolvent, at that point in time, the unpaid seller can actually stop the goods in transit. So right of stoppage the goods in transit can be exercised only when the buyer becomes insolvent. So the correct answer is B. Okay, 13th, A threatened to commit a suicide if his wife did not execute a sale deed in favor of his brother. The wife executed the sale deed. This transaction is A, voidable due to undue influence. B, voidable due to coercion. C, void being immoral. D, void being forbidden by law. Guys, it is coercion. You have forced someone to do something which he was not willingly doing. So, and yes, if you talk about a threat to commit suicide, it very well is covered under the provisions of coercion. If you have entered into a contract which is a fallout of coercion, then it is not a valid contract. So yes, this contract is voidable due to coercion. Okay, sir, got it. Which one of the following statements is correct? You need to tell which one is the correct statement. ए वॉइड अग्रीमेंट आर ऑलवेज इलीगल. सो वॉइड अग्रीमेंट आर इलीगल अग्रीमेंट्स. स्टेटमेंट नंबर वन. स्टेटमेंट नंबर टू, इलीगल अग्रीमेंट्स आर वॉइडेबल. इलीगल अग्रीमेंट्स कैन बी रेटिफाइड बाय पार्टीज. नो नो सर. सो दिस इज रॉन्ग. दिस इज रॉन्ग. वॉइड अग्रीमेंट्स आर ऑलवेज इलीगल. दिस इज एब्सोल्यूटली रॉन्ग. सो ऑब्वियसली द आंसर इज डी. लेट्स रीड व्हाट इज डी. इलीगल अग्रीमेंट्स आर ऑलवेज वॉइड. एब्सोल्यूटली करेक्ट. सो द करेक्ट आंसर इज डी. सो गाइज, इलीगल अग्रीमेंट्स आर ऑलवेज वॉइड, बट वॉइड अग्रीमेंट्स आर नॉट ऑलवेज इलीगल. सो द करेक्ट आंसर इज डी. ओके सर. क्वेश्चन नंबर 15. In pretended bidding, what is pretended bidding, guys? Pretended bidding is when the auctioneer or his person or someone known to him sits in the auction, and to raise the bid artificially, they give bidding. They bid to raise the bid artificially. This is known as pretended bidding. So let's see what is the question. Question says, in pretended bidding, sale is voidable at the option of the seller, is valid. Voidable at the option of the buyer is illegal. The correct answer is voidable at the option of the buyer. No guys, it's not good to have pretended bidding in your auction, because if you are auctioneer who has done pretended bidding, then the buyer can refute the sale. He can say that, okay, I don't want the sale to happen. So it is voidable at the option of the buyer. Question number 15. Okay sir. Question number 16. B, having discovered a vein of ore on the estate of A, adopts mean to conceal and does conceal the existence of ore from A. So guys, A has got an estate, has got a property, and B has discovered ore, some rare metal in that particular property. But B does not want to disclose this fact to A. Owing to A's ignorance, B is unable to buy the estate at a very low price. The contract is valid, contract is void, contract is voidable at the option of A, or contract is invalid. So guys, A is not aware about the ore which is there in that particular estate. A doesn't know about that ore. So B buys the estate at a very, very low price, at a very, very nominal price. Is this particular transaction, is this particular contract a valid contract, void contract, voidable at the option of A, or invalid? Guys, the answer is voidable at the option of A, because it was not based on true facts, it was not based on true discovery of facts. So B knew one thing which he did not disclose to A. So since it was not the contract was not based on true facts, therefore the contract is voidable at the option of A. Okay sir. Question number 17. A paid rupees 500 to a government servant to get him a contract for the canteen. Bribe against the public policy. Yes sir. The government servant could not get the contract. Can A recover 500 paid by him to the government servant? You tell me, can A recover it? Answer is of course no sir. He cannot recover it. Why? Because the agreement is void. Let's read the other options as well. Yes, the agreement between them is valid and enforceable. Absolutely wrong. Yes, the agreement is not opposed to public policy. Wrong. No, the agreement is voidable and can be avoided by A. The answer is agreement is void, because any contract which is against the public policy is void. It is not voidable. Any party cannot make it valid. No, it is a void contract. It is not a valid contract. Okay, sir. Question number 18. Under section 118 of the Negotiable Instrument Act 1881. So we are talking about the Negotiable Instrument Act 1881. Okay, sir. Under section 118, Negotiable Instrument Act, it is presumed until contrary is proved that every transfer of negotiable instrument was made after maturity, before maturity, at maturity, or none of the above. Answer is before its maturity. So unless and until it is proved otherwise, it is an implicit assumption, it is a presumptive assumption that every negotiable instrument has been transferred or was made, was transferred at a particular point which is before the maturity. We assume this in Negotiable Instrument Act. Question number 19. Which of the following statement is false in connection with a contingent contract? Contingent contract is a contract which is dependent on occurrence of a future uncertain event. That is a contingent contract. Yes, sir. We remember. So, the options are A. The event must be collateral, which means there should be two events which are there, which are parallelly running. The event must be uncertain. Yes, sir. The event must be uncertain. The event should not be mere will of promiser. So, yes, merely will of one of the promiser is not a contingent contract. It is not uncertain because at the will of the promiser, it will be certain. So, it is not uncertain. None of the above. Answer is none of the above because all of these statements are correct. The event must be collateral. Collateral means soon as event happens, the contract should also happen. This is known as collateral events. So, the event must be collateral. Yes, the event must be uncertain. Yes, the event should not be mere will of the promiser. Yes. So, the answer is none of the above. Question number 20. Who is liable for necessaries supplied to a minor? So, if you out of mercy supply necessities to the minor, who is liable to repay you? A. Guardian of the minor. B. The minor. C. His property. D. None of the above. Correct answer is his property. His estate. Yes. His estate is liable to pay you if you are not a minor and still you are giving some necessaries to a minor. And if you are giving some necessaries to a minor, then minor should not be liable to pay. But yes, his estate, his property should be liable to pay. Sir, if I provide luxuries to a minor, then no, his property is not liable to pay. Sorry. Check is a. So, what kind of instrument is a check? Promissory note, bills of exchange, both A and B, none of the above. Sir, it is bills of exchange. So, a check is a bill of exchange. Yes, sir. We have read it in our chapter. A contract stands discharged by performance of the contract, B by breach of the contract, by agreement and novation, and all of the above. Sir, the right answer is all of the above. Yes. Either you complete the contract or you rescind the contract or you novate the contract. In all the three cases, the contract stands discharged, the contract stands ended. Question number 23. A maturity of a promissory note or bills of exchange is the date at which it falls due, of its presentation, of its acceptance, none of the above. Answer is the date at which it falls due, it becomes matured. Whether you present it or not, whether you encash it or not, whether you accept it or not, the day on which it is due, it becomes executed, it becomes matured. So, the correct answer is A, at which it falls due. Question number 24. Where parties to a contract have agreed that a certain sum of money would be paid in case of breach of contract, the court will ensure that. So, the parties have agreed that certain money will be paid in breach of contract. What will the court do? Court will ensure that A. Exact amount mentioned in the contract is paid to the injured party. B. An amount not exceeding the stipulated amount is awarded. C. Reasonable compensation not exceeding the amount stipulated is awarded. D. A sum exceeding the amount stipulated is awarded. Of course, this is not the answer. Guys, the answer is C. Because damages are paid not to give you profit, but to compensate you for the loss. But it cannot be more than the stipulated amount which is written in the contract. So, court will ensure that you give a stipulated amount, a reasonable amount to the party who is injured. But that amount should be a reasonable amount, not a amount which gives profit to the other party. Amount should not be that. Okay, sir. Question number 25. Dash days grace period is allowed for payment of check. So, what is the grace period which is allowed for payment of check? A. 0. B. 3 days. C. 2 days. D. 7 days. Answer is 3 days. 3 days grace period is allowed for payment of a check. Okay, sir. 26. A foreigner is competent to enter into a contract if he fulfills the conditions of section 1. Is not competent to enter into the contract. C. Can enter into the contract with permission of central government. D. Can enter into contract with permission of court. Sir, he is eligible to enter into a contract if he fulfills the conditions of Section 11. Guys, there are so many foreigners who are in India. There are so many foreign nationals who are in India. There are citizens of other countries who are staying in India for so many years. Of course, they don't need any central government permission or court's permission to enter into a contract. They just need to be a valid party to the contract. And if they follow all the essential elements of a contract, then they are very well eligible to enter into a contract. Okay, sir. So the correct answer is A. Okay, sir. 27. An agreement to sell is an executory contract, executed contract, neither A or B, sometime A or B. The answer is executory contract. When you agree to sell in near future, then that agreement is known as executory contract, which means it will be executed in near future. It has not been executed as yet, but it will be executed in near future. An executory contract is agreement to sell. Okay, sir. Question number 28. Cross offer does not constitute a contract because, so if I give you an offer and you give an offer back to me with a reduced amount, then what happens? Cross offer does not constitute a offer because, what is the reason why it does not become offer? There is no acceptance. There is implied acceptance. Crossing implies cancellation. It amounts to counter offer. So of course, the answer is there is no acceptance. Lack of a contract, lack of acceptance in this particular contract will lead to cross offer being abolished. Cross offer becomes invalid because the original offer does not have any acceptance and a new offer is given. So there is no acceptance, so cross offer becomes a dead contract, a void contract. Whether stipulation is a condition or a warranty depends on, so what is the defining criteria of what is a condition and what is a warranty? It depends on A, construction of the contract, B, conduct of the parties, C, trade or custom, D, local law. Guys, the correct answer is construction of a contract. How do you treat that particular stipulation in your contract? Are you treating it as a compulsory must kind of a stipulation? Or are you treating it as a optional stipulation or a stipulation which is just collateral or secondary to the main purpose of the contract? How are you treating that stipulation to be? That is the moot point while considering whether the stipulation is a warranty or a condition. So answer is construction of a contract. Question number 30. The communication of an acceptance is complete as against the acceptor. The person who is accepting, the communication of acceptance is complete as per the acceptor. Under what of the following situations? A, when it is posted. No, sir. Posting is a completion acceptance as against the offerer. Remember, so this is not the right answer. When it is put in course of transmission. No, it is not the right answer. When it comes to knowledge of the proposer. Yes, this is the right answer. So, the acceptance is complete as against the acceptor when this acceptance reaches the offerer. None of the above is the wrong answer. So the correct answer is C, when it comes to the knowledge of the proposer. Question number 31. A contractor had to supply the army chapois in certain quantities by installment. He failed to supply the requisite number and even after that breached the installment of chapois was received by the army authorities. Meanwhile, the work orders were, however, cancelled. The order cancelling the work order were. So the order which cancelled the work order in this situation is valid, void, without authority, or contractor could claim the damages. Sir, void. How? Let's read the question once again. A contractor had supplied army chapois. Army chapois are some army equipments which are used by the soldiers. In certain quantities by installment, he failed to supply the requisite number. And even after breach, the installment of charpais was received by the army men. So, the army charpais were to be received in a particular quantity, in a particular manner. The manner was not fulfilled, the quantity was not fulfilled, the timeline was not fulfilled. Even after that, when timeline was not fulfilled, even when the installment went after the timeline, military didn't object to it, military accepted it. So guys, if military accepted it, if military did not object to it, then guys, the the order cancelling the work order is void because you shouldn't have accepted it. The military shouldn't have accepted it. The action of the military of accepting the charpoys beyond the stipulated time period in itself tantamounts to validation of the breach of contract. The breach is no longer invalid. The breach is valid because the military men have accepted the late installment of charpoys. So if the other party accepts your breach of contract, then that breach of contract doesn't remain a breach of contract at all. Yes, sir. The other party should have rescinded that breach of contract. Question number 32. In a book depot, a catalogue of books enlisting the prices of each book and specifying the place where particular book is available is A, an invitation to offer, an offer, an invitation to visit the bookshop, none of the above. Guys, a brochure which is enlisting a particular books and the places where these books are kept is merely an invitation to visit the bookshop. It is not even an invitation to offer. It is merely an invitation to visit the bookshop. So you are invited to visit your bookshop, and that is how this particular catalog will be construed to be. Okay, sir. Question number 33. Voluntary transfer of possession from one person to another person. So if you transfer the possession of goods from one person to another person voluntarily, it's known as ownership, delivery, gift, license. Guys, it's known as delivery. The correct answer is B. Naturally, if you transfer the possession of goods from one person to another person, this tantamounts to delivery. Ownership is not transferred. No, no. Ownership will be transferred only when the legal documents are executed for transfer of ownership. Yes, sir. A valid consideration includes. So what are the inclusions to a valid consideration? Executed or executory consideration? Past consideration? Inadequate consideration? All of the above? Guys, all of the above. So you remember, in Indian law, past consideration is a valid consideration, but in foreign law, past consideration is not a valid consideration. So in this case, when we are studying from an India standpoint, from an Indian law perspective, then guys, the answer is all of the above, because all these are valid consideration, executed or executory, the consideration which has been executed in past or which is yet to be executed in future, both are valid consideration. Past considerations are valid considerations. Inadequate consideration is a valid consideration. So the answer is D, all of the above. Okay, sir. The term unpaid seller includes, so who is an unpaid seller? Yes, sir. Buyer's agent to whom bill of lading is endorsed. So a buyer's agent whom the bill of lading is endorsed. So bill of lading is the document which is given in case of imports and export, guys. So if you entrust bill of lading to a particular agent, then is that agent can be termed as an unpaid seller if he's not paid? Yes, sir, he can be. Buyer's agent to whom goods have been delivered. Yes, an agent can be termed as a unpaid seller if that agent has not received his money. So buyer's agent to whom the goods have been delivered. Seller's agent to whom the bill of lading is endorsed. So guys, this is not an unpaid seller. Seller's agent to whom the goods have been delivered. Yes, he is validly an unpaid seller. So out of these, who is not a an unpaid seller? Guys, only and only seller's agent is an unpaid seller. So the correct answer is C. The seller's agent is an unpaid seller. Unpaid seller whom bill of lading is endorsed can be included in the term of unpaid seller. If he's a seller's agent, then guys, that agent will not be termed as the unpaid seller. The original seller, the principal seller, will be termed as the unpaid seller. And of course, buyers cannot be termed as the sellers. They are the buyers. So the correct answer is C. Okay, sir. Question number 36. In India, a person who is a stranger to consideration can sue on the contract. A person who is a stranger to consideration, can he sue on the contract? On the contract, if he is a party, cannot sue the contract. Depends on the party, depend on the circumstances. Answer is A. Stranger to a consideration, yes, can sue on the consideration. And we had studied the classic case in which the mother had asked her daughter to pay something to the uncle, maternal uncle, and the, all the estate of that mother was to be transferred to the daughter. In that case, daughter stopped paying to the uncle. Uncle can sue for consideration. 37. S sells certain goods to B of Bombay. So S, who sells certain goods of certain goods to B of Bombay, the goods are handed over to the railways for transmission to B. Goods are given to railways for transmission to B. In the meantime, B sells the good to third party T for consideration. Without consent of S, B becomes insolvent. In this case, S has the right to stoppage in transit. S has lost the right of stoppage in transit. Station master has the right of stoppage in transit. Or none of the above. Guys, the correct answer is station master has the right to stoppage in transit. Now, let's see what has happened in this particular question. Let's see, analyze the facts of the case first. So, S sells certain goods to B of Bombay. S sells goods to B of Bombay. The goods are handed over to railways for transmission to B. So, liability is on the railways to transmission the goods to B. In the meantime, B sells the goods to T, third party. B further sells the goods to T for consideration. Without consent of S, he did not take consent of S, B becomes insolvent. So, the goods can be stopped in transit by the person who is actually at that point in time in hold of that good. And who's that person? The station master of that particular railway. So, the correct answer is C. Yes, sir. M is a minor. Okay, sir. Again, the question of a minor, and it's really risky to contract with a minor. We have studied that. Let's see what is the question. M is a minor. B, the borrower, approaches M for a loan on the basis of mortgage of house owned by B. So, B approaches M for a loan, and B says, okay, keep my home as the mortgage. M advances the money, and B executed mortgage in favor of M, a minor. In these circumstances, A, mortgage is not enforceable by M because he is a minor. No, guys, mortgage is very well enforceable by M. M, despite of being a minor, can recover his rights, can recover his lawful possessions. B, the mortgage is enforceable, but only when he attains majority. No, not true. Minor can enforce anything even when he is a minor. The mortgage is enforceable by M even when he is a minor. Perfect. The correct answer is C. C is the correct answer. Guys, you cannot trick a minor. Minor has unlimited rights. Minor has unlimited powers. So, even if you try to defraud the minor, minor won't be affected because there are ultimate powers which are given to the minor. Question number 39. Threatening to commit certain acts forbidden by Indian Penal Code is associated with which one of the following? A, misrepresentation. B, fraud. C, coercion. D, unenforceable. Answer is coercion. If you threaten someone to do something which is illegal, something which is beyond law, then the guys, that act of yours is known as coercion. You are forcing someone else to do something. And question number 40. A contract to trade with an enemy. So, if you have done a contract to trade with an enemy, you have an enemy means enemy country. A, an immoral agreement. It's an immoral agreement. B, a valid agreement. C, an agreement opposed to public policy. D, an enforceable agreement. Answer is C. It is an agreement opposed to public policy. And what is the result if an agreement is opposed to public policy? Sir, it is void ab initio. So, yes, this agreement in which you contract to trade with an enemy is void ab initio. Why? Because it is against to public policy. So, you are not following the public policy. It is against the public policy. So, this kind of contract will be a void contract. Okay. So, that's all for this particular section of Law and Ethics MCQs, guys. And do not forget to complete these MCQs, these bid questions, because bid questions are very, very easy, as I've told you in the beginning of the lecture. I'll be coming up with the balance questions of this bid questions, and probably I'll be targeting to complete all the questions of bid questions at least, because bid questions are very, very important. So, yes. We'll be meeting in our next session with the next set of bid questions. Till that time, all the very best and happy studying.